Welcome to all of you. Thank you for joining us at this really interesting event. It's something that will never ever happen again. So your presence is important as we remember Leandra Wai-Rodrigues and Puhipau and Kekuni Blasdell. Let me remind you that...
Is it okay to do announcements? Like bathroom is blah, blah, blah. You can park any place now?
Oh, we can do it after.
Okay. So we're going to go right into our program. I'm just here to say aloha, welcome. There's food back there, and I'm turning the mic over to Andre.
Aloha āina kākou. Aloha. Just want to let everyone know what's happening right now. We're going to start off with a short ceremony here at the Ahu. Of course, the significance of this Ahu to Kekuni, to Puhipau, to Leandra from 1993, representing unity amongst our Lahui, where the Pohaku came across the Pai Aina from all over to build this Ahu. And as the years have gone by, this Ahu has been very significant to us, in particular to the sovereignty independence movement. So we're going to open with a small ceremony here. And we have some alakai who will lead the ceremony, and that at some portion will signal people if they want to come and offer a pule or oli. You can do that, but we'll start with the pu in just about a minute, and the ceremony will begin. So we want to ask people to no filming during the ceremony. If we can cut off the cameras just for the ceremony and afford Kekuni, Leandra, Puhipai that dignity and that privacy of our spirituality, yeah? So for the portion, no filming, please. And then follow along with us. Mahalo.
Mahalo Nui Loa for coming today, this beautiful rain and this beautiful place. One thing we'd like to do, a lot of our purpose here is to mahalo, to give our mahalo for the time that
it's on now.
These awesome people have spent walking this earth with us and all of the great work that they've done. And in order to do that great work, we as a Lahui recognize the great sacrifice that the families have given, you know, that time that these heroes of Aloha Āina spent doing this work came in many, many ways from time that they couldn't spend doing the things that their heart wanted them to do for the families, with their families. And the families continue to support, and we really mahalo that. So one thing we would like to do, we are going to have Ava specifically to honor the families. So if we can ask the family members to come forward so that
Ako imai kalahele and Auntie Le Niheo will be offering, will be offering that in honor to, in order to honor the families. So mahalo.
Aloha kakeiaka, lahui Hawaii, Kaukaohu Wahilani, Wahilani, Lahui News, as well as for Lelong TV. We're here at Ku'u Ilolani Palace for the celebration of life for our three alakai who had wahala, hele loko kalani, anakala Kekuni Blasdell, me anake Leandra Wai. Anake Leandra Wai and anakala Puhipau. So we're here at Ilolani Palace, and right now Uncle Imai Kalahele as well as Tita Le Niheu are doing a protocol, giving ava to the descendants, to the family members of the three that had passed. So this is a beautiful day, you know. Kiako has blessed us with the ua came down, but didn't like drizzle. So we're here in the celebration of life with all our lahui. Mahalo nui. Mahalo nui. Kiako me naku puna. Yes. Mahalo. Mahalo. As you can see, we have the ahu over here. And so this is a celebration going right now. So it's a little somber moment, but mai kai loa. Mahalo nui to Brother Oren, Brother Scotty, you know, as we get our lahui around over here. Yeah, see a lot of leaders here, a lot of people that came, patriots of our lahui. So mahalo, mahalo.
You're live.
So we have a lot of organizers here today, a lot of Hawaiian practitioners. Andre Perez, along with Laulani Teal, they kind of organized this event for our Ku'u beloved leaders. You can see everyone here. It's beautiful to see our lahui here and our kupuna. Maikai loa. So we have in the back Auntie Po Nani Rogers. That's from Mano Kalani Po, one of our kupunas from Kauai. And to the right, got Uncle George Fukumitsu, Kalo man from Hakipu'u. Yeah, so we have Uncle John Osorio right here. Yeah, Professor Osorio. In the foreground, we have one of our young Manawahines, Sister Shelley Munioka. And Anji Perez is in the back of him, in the foreground. Pono Kealoha. So maikai, maikai. Oh, and if we turn right here, I have Auntie Walter B there, from Wai-Anae over here. So maikai. So, and we have all our lahui over here and family. Oh, we have Uncle Larry Kimura in the back there with Auntie Lolena. We have Lancelot Haile Lincoln, yes. Auntie Lolena, she's a descendant from Ni'ihau, yes. Right here in the back there. In the back, yeah, that's Uncle Larry Kimura, and then in the back of Uncle Larry on the right is Auntie Lolena Nicholas from Kauai, Nihau. Yes. So, Mana Leo, Yaoi. So, it's a beautiful day today. Yeah. So, mahalo nui to everyone who came out and who's still coming out here. So, we're going to be here all day today. Yes. Just to gather and kuka kuka. And just love one another here. So, Lahui Hawaii. Mahalo. We have Ed Grievy here.
Captured the movement.
I was just told that Ed Grievy over here is a documenter. We have one of our young warriors over here too, Brother Shane Cobb Adams right here. Mr. Cobb Adams. Yes. PhD candidate. Warrior for Lahui, PhD. Ms. Yanko Imai Kalahele Lini. Yes, Auntie Uncle Imai. Yes, his grandson Imai. He's Uncle Puhipau's descendants right here. So that's what they're giving Ava to the family members of our deceased beloved Alakai. I know Kiaoko has blessed us with a little rain today. We heard some thunder earlier, but you know, we'll stay here and you know, it's all in love. It's all in love. So aloha.
For the 286th time, I see you in the event.
Aloha. Kaukaohu. Nice to meet you. So, Mr. Grievy, Oren had told me that you had done a lot of documentary on the sovereignty movement. You want to share some of your mana'o, Mr. Grievy?
Hold on, let me get you on live stream, by the way.
Yeah. Protocol, eh? Protocol.
I have a show.
Yes.
69 friends at KCC Library till April 15th.
All right.
Pretty much chronicles the last 40 years of mostly movement events, so to speak. More in the 70s and 80s than currently. Because everybody has a camera these days.
Yes, technology. Technology.
In the 70s they didn't. I had, and I was interested in working with people to defend against interests more powerful than they were. So that was my reason for doing all of this. Ended up with a big collection of pictures.
Awesome. So, Mr. Grievy, of all your years in documenting this sovereignty movement, can you give me one? Well, there probably are many, but just one memory that you know that stands out in your mind.
Well, back in about 1974 or 5, there was a big rally and march and demonstration at the Capitol opposing evictions, stop all evictions rally. And there was a time, the group that I was marching with came late to the Capitol and the rally was already going. Pete Thompson was MC on the microphone. And he asked the crowd to part so that we could all, the group I was with, could join. And at that time, I was just struck by something. Things are going to change. There's going to be, I don't know what or how, but this is too big a deal to, and it's taken a long time. And so that particular event stands out in my mind. Because up to that time, I looked at all these eviction struggles as kind of one-shot deals here and there, and for the most part, once the eviction issue was resolved, the group that had coalesced around that sort of went back to what they were doing. But on that day, I thought this, you know, could be bigger, and it has grown a lot. I as far as Hawaiian sovereignty, you know, the genie's out of the bottle. So many young people now, many more than I used to see back in the 70s and 80s, spending time and energy learning about the past and looking for new ways to do things, so to speak, that are more equitable to Hawaiians in particular, but not just Hawaiians, everybody actually. So those are kind of my thoughts, so to speak. Anything else?
Yes, do you have anything that you'd like to, any words of encouragement that you'd like to say to the younger generation? You know, like myself, I'm 50, but we have younger ones that Mauna Kea has brought, like Ho'okai, Kanuha, who's 26, Havane Rios, who's 28, so yes.
Well, the big change we talked about is the technology. I mean, the web, the TMT movement probably wouldn't have grown to its size and impact 30 years ago. I mean, it would have been an issue, but as Koho'olawe was. Koho'olawe was probably the last really big issue that wasn't influenced by technology. It happened just prior. But now, you know, the Hawaiian movement is worldwide. So I just say, keep at it. It's had a good start, but keep going.
Thank you. Thank you, Lahui. That was Mr. Ed Grevy right here.
So
thank you.
Is this going to be at the Academy Awards next year?
Okay. Yes, I know.
Can we get over here?
Come
here.
Yeah, come here, Uncle Baron. Lahui Hawaii, if you already know this person, this is Uncle Baron Ching, who's been in the movement for a long time. So, aloha kakaiaka, Uncle Baron.
Aloha kako. Yeah, my name is Baron Ching, and I'm glad to be here on this day and to remember these wonderful people. Kekuni was my teacher, and the reason I got involved in all of this was, you know, we're doing La Hoi Hoi Ea, and, you know, so we're collaborating with Kekuni trying to do this. And I'm thinking to Kekuni, well, Kekuni, what can we do? What can I do to promote more justice, you know, on these islands? And Kekuni said, well, you go hang out with Lynette Cruz. That's why I got hooked up with all of this craziness. But yeah, but it was Kekuni. And only later I found out, hey, Kekuni is the guy who actually made the medical school. Like, wow, this guy, amazing guy. And I do miss him. And he's been an inspiration, my teacher, my role model. Yeah, a wonderful man. As for Puhipau, experienced him in 2002 when we did the Huaka'i Mauna Kea, and he and Joan Landers were up there and photographing this, taping this, and well, we had a few mishaps, and of course my portion was cut to about 5 seconds on the film, but hey, still, we were on the film. Hey, that was cool. And for Leandra, of course, Leandra. Interacted with her a lot of times, many times, on this very grounds over here.
So we have finished at Makua.
Anyway, that's it. Thank you.
Of Puhipau, Leandra,
that's Uncle Baron Ching.
Honoring the families of those Aloha Āina with Ava and thanking them for allowing us to share the lives of their family, especially in the movement, as we know it takes so much time away from our families for this the struggle that we're in. At this time, we have some very dear friends of Leandra Vai, who are going to come and kani kapila for us. If I could introduce the members of Alulike from Nanakuli.
Yo.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, aloha everyone. Mahalo nui to Alolike o Nanakuli. Mahalo. At this moment, we're going to have some more music come up for a few songs, and then we're going to move into the portion where we honor each ohana of the ohana of Leandra Vai of Kekuni Blasdell and Puhipau. So please stick around, and also we're serving lunch at 1 o'clock. We have a lot of food. Last night, one of our friends, Daniel Anthony, made an emu, so we have lots of food coming from the emu. So please stay for lunch. Also for the restrooms, the Kanaka building, if you go down Mauka along the right side of the building, the first set of stairs on the right side of the building, you go left and up, and the bathrooms are open over there. Yep. Also, we want to remind everybody to akahele, be careful. The grass is uneven. There's little potholes here and there, and a couple people have tripped and almost fallen down already. So akahele when you walk, be careful for the potholes and the roots from the monkey pod. One more announcement. The ahu is now Noah. The kapu is lifted. So if anybody wants to give ho'okupu, please feel free to take it upon yourself to present ho'okupu at the ahu, whether it's a lei or a pule or an oli. It's open. Mahalo.
This is our beloved Uncle Spocky Rodriguez, his wife, as we know, he celebrated today at the Leandra Vai.
Yeah, I need
to
make sure I'm sorry.
Bye-bye.
You have anything you
want to
share?
One more announcement.
Yeah, I have, you know, there's...
The ahu is now Noah.
There is something that I learned from the Wahiwa Hawaiian Civic Club just recently. And for me, it helped explain all of the things that Leandra was doing, even Queen Liliuokalani was doing, and Kekuni and Puhipau.
It's open.
The word was ʻAina. So ʻAina in the old Hawaiian definition was family. So we're from the ʻAina and to us, and then we return to the ʻAina. Yeah. But what was key for me was that it started telling me the explanation of what ʻAina meant. It meant everything. So family and ʻAina is not separate. Whereas ʻOhana for me was, well, this is my separateness. And everybody else is separate in their own ʻOha and ʻOhana. Yes, yes. But ʻAina, as family, now becomes inclusive, everything. So the Hawaiian endangered species that cannot speak, they're part of our ʻAina and part of our family. So one of the things that she was saying was
thank you.
Iki ʻAina, know your family.
Yes.
Malama ʻAina, take care of your family. And aloha ʻAina, love your family. So the sign that we have up there, Aloha ʻAina,
yes,
is a perfect fit for describing our family and the work that we do. So it's not a separation, and it's all part of. So today, looking at the Queen, Puhipau, Kekuni, Leandra, they all did separate things, but it was all part of the ʻAina, our family. And the work continues, so everybody got to chip in and find their
where
gift
you give voice
and work on it,
to some of
whatever
the songs
that might
that were
be.
Written during the overthrow.
That's my start for today.
Of,
do you want to share any manao to the?
And so I wanted to
the young Aloha ʻAina teachers who are coming. You know, like Manawa Ke has brought, you know, a lot of young leaders, the next generation. Like I'm 50, but the younger ones, like Ho'okahian, you know, Kanuha, okay, and Havani Rios and Anakila Manguel, they're all in their mid-20s to late-20s.
I did not remember.
Do you have anything,
so I'm gonna do, what I have.
Words of inspiration that you want to share?
I'm
going to
start with a song that was written for Robert Wilcox.
Finding your gift is the hardest part. And then once you do, it's a matter of following the voices. So like I said, ʻAina as being family, it's not only the present family, it's the past kupuna and all of those that have yet to come. So those voices, if you listen, if you quiet yourself enough, and that's kind of what Leandra did. She started showing me that being quiet and listening to the ʻAina will teach you some of the ancient knowledge. Then you have to demonstrate it to work through all of the errors that we have because of our colonization and our Western upbringing. So with the youth, it's sometimes confusing because how we were taught and what we might feel, totally different. And for me, growing up, it was always anger. But that was not necessarily the truth. It was misunderstanding and the conflict and how I was brought up and what was being taught in school and what I was feeling. So now that you're listening to the ʻAina, you're getting that true thing. So the guys that are coming up, if we can quiet ourselves long enough to listen and then follow those verses. So the challenge is very hard because with our lifestyle of constant moving, we don't quiet our stuff enough to listen to the ʻAina and to listen to our family past.
He attended Haleakala boarding school in Makawao, and when he graduated, Robert Wilcox, he became a teacher. In 1880, he was elected to the Royal Legislature.
Aloha, good morning, everyone. Oh, mahalo, thank you. Yeah, I wasn't sure how to do that one. Okay. Okay, sorry. My name is Sam Kilihumalu. Aloha, good morning, everyone. I was asked to put together a little project where you give voice to some of the songs that were written during the overthrow of the Hawaiian Kingdom. And so I wanted to, that way you can kind of understand the mindset of some of the people, some of the major players who were involved in this overthrow. Okay. And unfortunately, I didn't bring everything with me. I'm so scatterbrained, I did not remember. So I'm going to do, well, what I have. I'm going to start off with a song that was written for Robert Wilcox by Mrs. J. Hapa. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with that name, Robert Wilcox was the guy who did the 1895 rebellion. And that was the one where they were trying to get, or trying to return Liliʻu back to the throne. And not always a good guy, because this was like his third rebellion. Two against the Hawaiian Kingdom and one to restore it, yeah? So this is the third thing. He's known as the Iron Duke of Hawaii. And if you go 4th Street Mall, you can find his statue there. If you go by NBC, Neil Blaisdell Center, across the street is TGI Fridays. And back there, they have the cemetery. And that's where Robert Wilcox is buried, along with his wife, Teresa Oana. And for those of you who are not familiar with that name, she's a descendant of the Nui family. They are one of the students who went to the royal school. And so that was their claim to the throne. Her living descendants today would be people like Oana Salazar. Okay. Alrighty. So he attended Haleakala boarding school in Makawao. And when he graduated, Robert Wilcox, he became a teacher. In 1880, he was elected to the Royal Legislature, and in 81, he was selected by Kalākaua to attend the Royal Military Academy in Turin, Italy. He returned home in 1887 because what happened was the bayonet constitution, the constitution that was forced upon Kalākaua, it ended the funding for his schooling. So some of us know that feeling, yeah? You're doing your project, your Hawaiian project for your betterment of your people, and then all of a sudden you're funding it cut. And so he came back home and he was upset. And so his upset was directed at Kalakaua. Fortunately, he didn't have a chance to act on it. Then he was upset with Liliʻuokalani a little bit later on in life for about the same reason. The bayonet constitution was really not comfortable for our people. Alrighty, well, enough talking, yeah. I'll sing this song. So this song written by Mrs. Hapa. And I just put it to a little tune. Leko way puwa oliva eluge maine kapalama kahia kakano I no Hawai ikano I akua uwe I ke maka ina ko lelo ake ko anui o ke ko anui ko ke kaupuni o wili ko ki a ka keu keu ina ko lelo ku wa ke aloha mehe mea la e ki mai ana e Hawai ki nui moku o ke ave hagina kapu ana I lo ke gia o wili koki hapa Italia. So just a little melody like that for Wilcox. Mahalo, thank you. Oh, you're very kind. Oh. The trick is finding everything in here. See, I had a thought that I was going to share some of these very interesting and strong songs with you, and then I forgot them. So we're going to do what we have. One of the songs that I wanted to share was, we know that Sam Wilcox fought. And what happened was the fight was over there at Diamond Head. They had stashed all their munitions at Black Point. Black Point is kind of like where Doris Duke lives. Yeah? So if you're familiar with that area, that's where the munitions were kind of hidden out there. And the Hawaiian group had decided that they were going to fight from two different angles. And they were going to sandwich the Americans in between them and then push them out into sea and back out. So that was the plan that was supposed to happen. And so this song is interesting because it's called Alakai Hohe Vale. And Alakai means the leader. Hohe means cowardly. And so he's very considered to be very cowardly. And the person that they're talking about in this song is Sam Nolan. And I always wondered, why do they call him a coward, you know? So the song tells us that the captain told them to hold the line and not to move so that they could sandwich those Americans together and push them out to sea. And unfortunately, what happened was they didn't hold the line. And so when they surrendered, the Americans were able to turn on the other line and start attacking them as well. And the guy who wrote this song, if I can find it, Alakai, there we go. Alakai ho he vale. Okay, the guy who wrote this song, he was imprisoned. So that's why if anybody had a right to call Nolan a coward, it would be the guy that got arrested for that, you know? So the guy who, his name was J.W. Kamali. Yeah, so this song does two things. It praises Robert Wilcox, and it explains to us why they thought Nolan was a coward. Let's see. If I can see it. So it tells us the date. It says on the 7th of January was when they did this. And let's try the song. We did a very easy melody, so we'll try it. Kalana mai nei, nai mana hila, o kapuku kaulana pōwena kole. I laila mākou i kana kai, i kapono kaulike o ke kaupuni. Makalahi ku oyanu ali hopamaka ke kawak akala hui mea ole na kowa o ke kaupuni ke iki vili koki kaulana nei. Hana I kaulana a ke akamai me nā o pio puku vai kila. Ualana haku koki koku manako ha ia apaka I ke kulana. Kārea e ka leo o ke kapena, pakaria ka ngapaka I ke kulana. E koa ka manako me ka vivo ole, a hopo ole koki I ka genemi. E ia ka ahe hohe valei, ale ka kaulana I tagalia. E iola mākou a pauloa, ale I ka lei o ka haupoli. Hāina I a mai, ana ka pauana, o sāmu no lena hohe vale. So that was my little song for Sam Nolan. Now we know Will Cox and we know Sam Nolan because their names are really famous, yeah? But I found another name of someone who was probably lesser known, but kind of important to me, at least. His name was John, well, I'll give you the full name. His name was John Avenei Kalani Keahi Okalua Pele Carrie Lane. And he was born in 1872. He was one of 12 kids born to an Irish sea captain named William Carrie Lane. And his mother was a Ko'olau chiefess. Her name was Mary Kukeakalani Kaho'oili Moku. And his mother was from Macau on the Ko'olau side of this island. Macau is like by Kaliuva'a and Kapaka and Hau'ula side, yeah? So John was educated at Hau'ula school. Then he matriculated, went to college at St. Louis College over here on this side of the Oahu. His jobs included, he was a clerk and a farmer. But how he plays into our scenario of Ku'e was that with his brothers, Lot and James, they were members of Lili'uokalani's personal guard at Ilolani Palace. Okay, and they were there for the 1895 rebellion. They took part in the counter-revolution. They were captured at the Battle of Diamond Head. And John was actually one of the first ones that they wanted to put into jail because John was the one who shot, or they accused him of shooting, Charles L. Carter. And he is one of those guys on the Committee of Safety. You know, the ones that said, oh, we are so afraid. The Hawaiians seem so savage. They're going to take over everything and ruin our businesses. Why don't you American warships come over and aim your guns at them so that they'll behave? Yeah. So for that, Mr. Carter got shot. Yeah, by John Carey. So John went to jail. After jail time, aligned himself with Prince Kuhio, and he became a Republican and began running under the Republican branch. People say, why'd he run Republican? Republican's not really friendly with us. But you got to remember, that was the power at the time in Hawaii. So if you want a piece of the pie, you got to align yourself with the people that are in power. Yeah? So after he did that, he became the mayor of Honolulu for a short time. And then he lost his election, but to the Democrat, Fern. So for those of us who know Fern Elementary School, Fern, he lost to Fern, Carrie Lane. And he became appointed the high sheriff and the warden of the Oahu prison. And he started doing that from 1922. He resigned in 1932. And the reason he resigned was because they were making him watch the boys who were involved in the Macy case. And he couldn't bring himself to put these innocent people behind bars for something that they didn't do. So this is John Lane. So when you're applauding, applaud for him, because that was the Hawaiian that did this. Okay? So, simple song, you know. And it's just a song in honor of John Lane. So this is a name to know for our kuʻes. So that's our song for Little Keoni Lane, yeah? Mahalo. Let's see. What else do I have? All right, I said I would do six, right? So that was three. Okay. Oh, okay. I have a nice little song. We were talking about the composer of this next song because she chose to kind of remain anonymous, but she goes by the name Kalihi Girl. So we were laughing. I was going, oh, Kalihi Girl, she must be on Tira. Okay. Now, Kalihi Girl wrote this song called Kolea Kau I Okahiki, 189. Let's see. Now, Kolea is our Hawaiian word for plover bird. And the reason that we, it's also a way that we talk about foreigners. And the reason they're compared to plover birds is because the old saying goes, they plover birds, they come from afar. They come over here to Hawaii, they eat, they get fat, sometimes they leave their kukai over here and then they run away and go someplace else. So that was the manao. They felt that the foreigners were doing that, even back in those days, in 1894, yeah. So this song tells them, don't get too comfortable with the ideas of wearing Lili'u's crown, because it's supposed to come back to her. Yeah? And it measures out her kingdom. It measures it from Ka'ehae to the sunset at Lehua. Yeah? So we're going to try to do this song. Now, you had to find a melody that would match a titta. So I tried to do something that would work. So we're going to try.
Mai hoko kumu mai koe Ike kala unu o liliku Ua ike I kalai kumu kahi Kau ake mano kalani No liliku no wia kapu No kawahi o Hawaii Nā hono a pikilani Molo katea kulu laga kau Ike mai ko pula pula Ke kui mea ka la hui E kanani hae ka la unu E mau kona velo wana Oni pa ako kaupuni e yowe liliku o kalani.
Our song from our tira, Kalihi Girl for Kolea Kau Ahua. I'm going to leave you with this last song, and this one I think you all know. It's not the songs that I sang. I put together a little pamphlet of maybe 16 songs, and hopefully it'll be available at Mary Monarch. But it's, I have a friend who might be bringing, if they don't sell, they might be returning back to Oahu, where I'll come and promote them. So this last song that I want to do for you all, I'm going to tell you the history about it, because I think the history is the most important part for this song. The chorus part, which goes, Ele ho'i elili ulanie, so you guys all know this song already, right? It was probably written by Konia. Konia is a granddaughter of Kamehameha the Great. And she was chanting outside of the place where Lili'u was being born, asking, hey, can I hanai this girl that you're having? And why is she hanaiing this girl? She's going to raise her as a sister for Bernice Pauahi Bishop. So when you hear our Hawaiian songs and Lili'u is saying she's a pua, a kamehameha, it's because she is the actuality, the hanai sister of Bernice Pauahi Bishop. So that's one claim. She also never forgot to mention that her kupuna, her real kupuna, was Keawea Heulu. Okay? They say, the story says that this song actually took place, came together at Washington Place, down the road there. Four ladies came and they sang this song for the birthday of Lili'u Kalani when she had already been deposed, but she was still at her home there. And they chanted the song. Most people don't tell you why, though. The reason they came there was because they were telling Lili'u that they felt that the reason that the Hawaiian kingdom had fallen apart was because they had abandoned the old gods. And so they were going to do a religious ceremony dedicated to the old gods. And Lili'u was kind of for the idea of turning towards God, and through the rest of her life, she would go from different religions trying to find God and to find a why. You know, but I know that she wasn't in particular wanting to turn back to the old religions because she knew that some part of the old religions, they included human sacrifice. And so she didn't want bloodshed again. So we get that same idea of no bloodshed for the kingdom. Yeah, do it peacefully. There's a way to find a peaceful solution. So I'm going to do this song for you all. And I hope you enjoy it. Oh, okay, not there. Maybe this one. Fingernails cracking. Had to hit the high notes so you would all wake up after my boring talk, yeah? Mahalo, I hope you all have a beautiful day. Well, I talked a lot. What would you guys like to hear? Okay. Okay. Sorry, I sing in weird keys. We'll try Kalananapo for y'all. Okay. You all sing along, okay? Kokuana konua kopi gilana ni
ka koko mai ka waki ko manana no hopu me ke one o ka kuhi he ni he mo a kole ma koua e mina mina I ka puku ka la ke ka upuku ani Walawa ma kou I ka pōha hākū I ka ae ka mā kō ka kai I mā Ama hope ma kou ho nili ani Aloha ka e ka pono ka karai I nā Hākina ki a mai ana
Oh, mahalo, and you all have a wonderful day.
Aloha kakai akalahui Hawai'i, Kaukaohu Wahilani, we're at Ilolani Palace for the celebration of life. Our Kuhi Palala area.
We're laughing with one, our Kalihi girl, she must
be on the chair. Give the mic to Andres just from now on today's event.
Aloha āina kākou. We're here at Ilolani Palace at a special place, as many of us know, at the Ahu. The Ahu that was built in 1993 as a symbol of unity. Here to honor today the lives lives and the important works of our Aloha āina kupuna for us, Dr. Kekuni Blasdell, Puhipau from Namaka Oka āina, and Leandra Vai from Makua. And so, we wanted to organize a celebration of life on behalf of the movement, the community, the Lahui, to honor them and to also mahalo their ohana for allowing them to do what they did in their lives, to spend the time that they needed to spend on the movement, on Malama āina, Aloha āina, independence, sovereignty, struggle, resistance, on all these decades of issues that we've been facing. So we really wanted to celebrate the lives of Leandra Vai, of Puhipau, of Kekuni, and we got together, just a few of us, and organized this event at the palace where we always gather, whether it's Sovereignty Sunday or other important events and gatherings. This is the place that we have so many memories. And so we're here today. The blessing came down, the ua, and I think it's fitting. Fitting situation for the passing of our Aloha āina. So we're here having a great time. Kanika pila with reflections and recollections and memories, celebration. We had an opening ceremony at the Ahu, cleansing ceremony with the Pukiawe, and lots of musicians. So we're here to honor those legacies and remember and continue and perpetuate what they stood for. Mahalo.
That was our beloved brother Andre Perez. Does a lot for the Lahui. Mahalo.
Yeah, mahalo. Thank you.
Aloha kakai aka lahui Hawai'i, Kaukaohu Kalani Wahilani, we're here. Celebration of life at Ilolani Palace for three alakais that came before us. Uncle Puhipau, Uncle Kekuni, and Auntie Leandra Wai. Right here, we're here with another Aloha āina patriot who's been in the fight for Lahui for some time. So we didn't. Without any further ado, it's my honor to introduce Dr. Rosario.
Aloha.
They say the story says that this song. You say your manawa on why you're here today.
At Washington Place, and down the road there.
So we're really grateful. I'm really grateful to be here, surrounded by a lot of people that, you know, I know have been involved in struggles for restorative justice, restoration of our kingdom, the ongoing fight to reclaim our sovereignty over our lands, over our people, and especially, you know, I think the kuleana, the ability to establish and to to exert our kuleana over the care of these lands.
Kind of for the idea and of turning towards God,
nobody really did that anymore, with any more commitment and with any more grace than the three individuals that we're honoring today. Kekuni Blasdell, Puhipau, and Leandra. First of all, because they were always with us, and at every single sovereignty gathering, you would find these people. And, from the early days when Puhipau was creating video documentaries, Act of War, Sand Island Story, Waimanalo Eviction, all of these things documenting for not only for Hawaiians, but for the general public as well in Hawaii and in the United States and in the world, the things that have been taking place here that have not been right, the criminal acts, the acts of genocide against Kanaka Maori. Yes, we should listen to this song. All of these things that that Puhipau documented with such care, he and Joan together, you know, making these things available for people. And, you know, they didn't get rich doing this thing. You know, this was an act of love. It was an act of nationalism. It was an act of commitment to the nation. For those kinds of things, all we can express is our tremendous gratitude for their work, for their commitment, for their courage, for their never-ending persistence and desire, you know, to let the truth be known. For Leandra, who was always present, you know, every time you saw her husband behind that camera of yours, you know, Leandra was nearby. And she was always doing whatever needed to be done. Many of us who got to know her over the years understood that, you know, if there was going to be something taking place, it didn't matter where it was, no matter how inconvenient, you know, the time or the day, she was going to be there even if you weren't. And so we're going to miss her, and we're going to miss her smile and just the beautiful way she had about it. And as for Kekuni, you know, someone who mentored so many individuals, not just Hawaiian activists, but people in the medical community, in the medical establishment, very well-established doctors and administrators. You know, he was truly a man with his feet in both worlds in Hawaii, you know, in that established higher education kind of community, but also in the activist community. He attended everything until he couldn't come anymore, until his body just made it difficult for him to move from one place to another. But even then, you know, you always knew when you visited him at his home in Nu'uanu that the only thing he ever wanted was just news of what was happening in the movement. He'd always ask how the lahui was, peheaka lahui. And, you know, and you better be able to tell him, you know, what was going on. That you better be able to tell him that you were still involved, that you hadn't given up, because, you know, he never would. So we're going to miss these people. And at the same time, as I've been talking to many people, you know, our time is coming too. You know, those of us who are getting old in this, we realize that, you know, we are basically where Kekuni was. In the last few years of his life, we are trying to be good role models to the younger people who are really the engines of this movement. So, and if I could just say this to all the OPO out there, just hula mua, because, you know, just take your place on this. It's been a good movement. It's been wonderful. And we have all of these elders who continue to show us the way.
Mahalo, Professor Rosario. One of our peaches right there, Professor Rosario.
Hey, aloha kākou. Aloha. At this time, we're going to move into honoring the lives and legacies of our Aloha Āina, Puhipau, Kekuni, and Leandra, one at a time. So we're going to start with Puhipau. And if we could ask the ohana of Puhipau to join us in the big tent, come forward for Puhipau. Uncle Imai Kalani Kalahele is going to offer up some words and reflection and recollection and sharing with us part of the story of Puhipau, followed afterwards by Kekuni and Leandra. But at this time, if you guys can come under the tent here, yeah? Are we like up front here? Can we make some room for Puhipau's ohana up here on the hali'i? And Uncle Imai Kalani Kalahele. Aloha.
Hey, Aze, aloha. I don't know what I'm going to say about my brother. First time I met Abe, he was the Sand Island Iceman. And not the kind of ice the guy most of you guys think about now. He used to actually deliver ice for the guys living in Sand Island. And during that eviction was when I really started to know brother. Back then it was Brother Abe. All those guys had our holy name. I was Brother Snake. From the struggles, when you start off in the struggle and you work through it, you get deep. What was the early 80s? 85. Yeah, around there. A group of people, something like 9 guys, used to meet at Solini Hale's house underneath the mango tree and plot the overthrow of America. Brave guys, us guys, but we're only talking to ourselves, so we know, okay. But what we did do was we started to develop a philosophy. And all the people, all the 9 people in Nauivi, Hawaii, became really tight. We eventually became a part of all the other movements, Kekuni, Sole, Keli, Kekai, Puipao, all those guys used to sit down and really start to examine what it is to be Hawaiian, what it is to fight for your independence. When we started Kalahoihoi Ea, it was the first time that celebration was held since the overthrow. It was a time that where we sat down and said, you know what? We gotta we gotta start to let our people know what belongs to us. And Puipau was an integral part of that. And Sister Joan, man, those two guys, Namakaoka Āina, there's a reason why it was called Namakaoka Āina, because it was the only eyes of our people. Puipau and Joan, what these guys went give birth to was an amazing history. If you look at all the young brothers and sisters carrying cameras now, most of those guys did it because of Puipau and Joan. Most of the documentation that's going on now where Hawaiians are actually telling our own stories had to do with the Hanawa of these two. These two people in Hanawa choke guys, man. Choke Kanakas. And now, if we look at what's happening, we got Hawaiians filming ourselves. We got Hawaiians telling our own stories. There was a time when there was only one source for Hawaiian imageries. If you wanted to see anything Kanaka, you got to call up Puipau guys and ask them, you guys get something about the birds? You get something about the trees? You get something about this guy Wilcox? You get something about, and all of a sudden we would get all these boxes of, well, started with video, eh? And, you know, it was a library. It was the only Hawaiian library that we had. And this one was visual. You don't have to read everything. But, you know, the real thing I loved about Puhipau and Joan is that throughout all of this, they were always Aloha Āina. Throughout all of the stuff that everybody has gone through, these people was koa. You know, I started to write something and then I would forget, but it kind of go like this. You know, there was a time when the stone walls were all taken down to go build roads. And then came this time when there was this foundation stones that was starting to be laid. You know, it probably started with Nabahi and went through all the guys that had passed, all became the floor foundation stones. So, you know, I thought about it and I was thinking, yeah, Baragai's gone. But you know what? They're the foundation that we're building our nation on. That is going to be our pa. And what a wonderful pa. I mean, a strong one. Puhipau was never afraid of anything. And I think that's one of the reasons that made Nauivi work. Because none of us was scared of anything. And one of the things I loved about Brother is that his love for Āina and his love for our people was real. Was real. And, you know, the only thing I can say is, I knew these buggers was going to come. Puhipau, thank you for the rain, my brother. So, I don't know. To the family, thank you guys so much for that. I mean, for real, man. You know, that Makich used to call him Papa Smurf, eh? Because he still look like Papa Smurf. But, you know, it's hard for me to say anything about somebody when you love the guy so much. Because all of a sudden, art goes out the window. All of a sudden, all that goes out the window. And all I can say is that I am so blessed to have known Puhipau. I am so blessed to have known his family and my sister, Joan. I am so happy that he had you in the end. Love you guys. Love you, Puhipau. And thanks for coming, eh? Wait. Okay, we're honoring the family of Puhipau, and it's happening now. you gotta read names. Okay.
Again, we really want to just mahalo the families for their for all that they've given of. You know, being for sharing Puhipau with us, you know, and for all that you folks have done in carrying him on too. You know, we know the sacrifice that's involved. We know how much we've benefited from the time that, you know, came from that family time and from all that you gave to feed that spirit so that we could go forward. So mahalo from the Lahui.
Aloha, I'd like to introduce Puhipau's first wife, ʻaulani Ahmad. They were both classmates, Kamehameha class of 55. And she's going to give you a little preview of his life before he became a sovereignty activist.
I'm ʻaulani Ahmad. My name is Fish, Poehauli father. way back when. But what I wanted to share with you is his pre-patriot life. We read that he was born in Hilo. His dad had met Mama Ahmad, Carrie Ahmad, in Kau in the 1930s. Now, where he came from, he was Arabian. How he got to Kau in those days, who knows? But then, and he married Mama, who had seven sons. Their last name was Henriques. And then the four Ahmads, his older sister, Holloway, wonderful name. And then Abe Puhipau was born second. And then there were twins, Momi and Harub. They were the babies. And Momi has passed, bless her heart. But Harub lives in Las Vegas. He was not able to come home. Took it very hard when he heard about his brother's passing. So now they're in Hilo. They come to Hawaii in the 40s. It was during the war days. His dad had a business. They moved here. They lived in Kuleo'o next to the Halls. And of all things, Kaiana married Judy Hall, the baby of that family. And they, so they knew Mama them when they were little. And then they moved to Pualane. And from Pualane, he went up to Kapalama Heights as a boarder at Kamehameha. I have a feeling that they grabbed him off the street and took him up there. And that was one of the best things. And he loved Kamehameha. Then he, after, it was a football star, football, basketball, and track. Excellent in track in high school. Then he played 1 year at Oregon University, Eugene of Oregon, for 1 year. Then he moved down to San Pedro, California, where he had his brothers that lived down there. He loved his brothers. And his brothers, there were about four of them, because there were seven of them, right, in the beginning. They were merchant seamen. And so he became a merchant seaman. And I know a lot of people don't know that. But he sailed, he was on the ships for about 10 years, sailing out of San Pedro. He would go around South America. He would go to the Orient along the Pacific Islands. And during the wartime, they went as far as Vietnam, dropping off goods and stuff to those areas. And when going up the river in Vietnam, they all had to stay indoors in the ship so that to avoid sniper fire. And that was an adventure for him at that. And then we were able to move home. And the kids were born in San Pedro. He named our oldest Eleo Henriques Ahmad. Eleo was his hui at Kamehameha schools. That's how much he loved Kamehameha. And that was his intramural hui. So he named Eleo after the hui, Henriques after his brothers, and then Ahmad. And I'll just put it all together that Eleo has changed his last name to Puhipau. That's how much he loved his dad. Then there was Kaiana Henriques Hossein Ahmad. Kaiana was a name we chose for him. We like that. And then Hussein was after his father. His father in Arabs, they have, like Chinese, they have two last names. And one of his last names was Hussein Ahmad. So Kaiana was blessed with Hussein. But he kept Ahmad. He hasn't changed his last name. And then he named our last son Vernon Paulo, S. Paulo Ahmad. Vernon after my father. Paulo after Uncle Walter Paulo. And you know Uncle Walter left his legacy, Opelo Fishing, the Wai-Nai Project, and we were so proud of him. He was our family, and he taught Opelo Fishing Miloli'i style, because that's where he grew up, and that was real special to have Uncle in our lives. So Vernon carries Uncle Walter Paulo's name. And then we move here, and the kids, we live in Kaneohe, proceed with my sister, and then Kaneohe, and the kids go to King Intermediate and Castle. Couldn't take them anywhere because as soon as they landed here, they threw away their shoes and went slippers and fishing. They got in with their uncles in the fishing. They love to fish. They're fishermen. They're watermen. They're dynamite divers. He'e, Kaiana is a he'e expert. And he learned from people that he knew on Molokai, and we give them credit for that. And So anyway, now we're in Kaneohe. He does a short stint in car sales. Then Sand Island happens. He loved it. He even the tutus that you all know used to go down there and spend time on Sand Island with them. And then the government got after them. And from then on, he took another path. And that was his passion. I'm stealing this from Ileo because Ileo said, you know, he donated his body to the Willing Body project at the medical school, the John Burns Medical School. And Joan finally got his ashes, so she's going to take that home with her. And Sand Island happened. And from then on, he just went. And Ileo said, I admired my dad or something like that, saying that he was able to have the freedom to do this, to work his passion, and he made it happen. And a lot of times we can't do the things that we want to do because we got to work, we have things that keep us from expressing ourselves, and he was able to do that, and which is Maika'i. And then he met his life partner, Joan, and that was Maika'i, and I'm so glad that she was with him to help him in his needs and when he was failing and whatever was in his health, whatever it was. And so we're real grateful to Joan for that. And so I just wanted you to know a little bit of his history because I can't talk about that, what you guys know about his patriotism and what he fought for, and that's all Maika'i. Because, you know, it's good that there is activism to keep the leaders of government, whatever it is, in check. There's somebody watching and looking and taking care. So that's all I want to say is that's his pre-life. And I hope that now that you know. And you know, when Hokulea went out, I thought, oh my God, maybe he should be on the Hokulea, the first voyage out, because he was a seaman. But he was on ships that had compasses and, you know, modern stuff. So I don't know if he even wanted to do that, but I'm proud when I got the call from Joan saying, Puhipau is calling you to say goodbye. That was wonderful. It was great. And I told him, I said, you know, we did good, you and I. We had way back when we had these beautiful sons. And Joan knows this, yeah. So, and it was the most wonderful call that I ever had from him. So, anyway, aloha and thank you.
Hi, aloha. My name is Lopaka Brown, and my experience with Joan and Abe was so special. My family originates from the Waimea Valley on the North Shore, and for 5 years they documented my movement to stay on the land there. You know, the funny thing is knowing that it wasn't impossible, but knowing that we won't be there, they documented everything for my family, and I truly appreciate it, and I'm honored right now that she had asked me to sing a song for him.
I just use the mic. Can you do it? Can you?
Ana no kamakani kaulana o kaina kani kaili aloha upuakue John, I love you folks. Thank you for all you do for our people and keeping our movement alive. I really appreciate it. Mahalo, everybody. Aloha.
Aloha. So at this time, I'd like to introduce Professor John Osorio, who will be introducing us or sharing with us a little bit about Dr. Kekuni Blasdell and his legacy and what he meant to the movement and to us as a mentor and as a role model and the dignity that he always shared with us or demonstrated for us. So Dr. John Osorio.
Aloha mai kako. Aloha everyone. It's good to see you here and it's good to feel the rain. I think, of course it's going to rain. We should have known that last night. I'm going to read parts of this only because, you know, I'm getting old and it's easy to forget, especially like details. But forgive me, but it's still, it comes from the heart. Richard Kekuni Akana Blasdell was born in Honolulu on March 11, 1925. Kaimuki and Waikiki were his playgrounds in his youthful days, and he became a student at Kamehameha in 1937. His life was, you know, it was shaped, it was fashioned by his experience at Kamehameha, by the mentoring of Dr. Donald Kilolani Mitchell, who encouraged him to become a medical doctor, and also by the attack on the American naval base at Pu'uloa in his junior year. Later, his appointment to the Atomic Bomb Casualty Commission in Hiroshima and Nagasaki made him one of the very few people in the world who witnessed both the attack on the American fleet, which he saw from Kapalama, and the terrible retribution that America would exact from the Japanese 4 years later. I think his compassion for people, his impatience and mistrust for powerful institutions probably came from his war and post-war experiences. But they also came from the encouragement and the mentorship of two amazing Kanaka who passed before him, Soliniheu and Puhipau. These were the folks who essentially introduced him to this struggle, who helped him form the tribunal in 1992 and 1993, and very much a part of his life and a part of his awareness of the sovereignty movement. I've known Dr. Blasdell as an activist in social and political movements for more than 30 years. I became acquainted with him shortly after he convened the early Kapakaukau forums exploring Hawaiian sovereignty in the 1980s. And I gave historical testimony at the Kolokolonui Kanaka Maoli in 1993. It was years before I learned actually how greatly esteemed he was in the medical profession and among Native Hawaiian practitioners in particular. And a few years ago, I was allowed to give an introductory speech when the members of his profession gathered to honor him and the scholarship program in his name. And I recognize what a powerful symbol he is to medicine and to all the best ideals that medicine represents: knowledge, self-reflection, discipline, and above all, compassion. The Dr. Blasdell that generations of med students and patients knew was no different from the Hawaiian patriot who insisted that we Hawaiians are not Americans, who used direct and uncompromising language when confronting powerful American institutions, who showed up at every sovereignty event, no matter how inconvenient, offering his encouragement and delight with activists. None of this is surprising, given the qualities of his intellect and personality, and especially given the greatness of his heart. When these qualities reside in a single individual, we usually find that that person walks, talks, and acts in many communities, some of them quite distinct and diverse from each other. I believe that Dr. Blasdell discovered something true and important in his professional, community, and political work over the years: that they are not separate, and that indeed they are mutually dependent upon one another for the truly effective individual. Kekuni knew, I think, the real secret of a perfectly satisfying life, that work is a blessing, and the people around us are the reason for the work. And if work is a blessing, then we must always be grateful to the people for whom we toil. Over the years and at various occasions, I heard Kekuni's name mentioned with the same kind of respect and affection that usually comes from people who have a first-hand experience with the man. Doctors who remember doing rounds with Kekuni Blasdell as medical students, and Hawaiian activists who know that if you want to try some new initiative to protect some ʻAina from a developer, to call out some politician, or to oppose some nefarious legislation or policy, you always wanted Kekuni aboard. He inspired confidence because he knew what he was doing and because he cared about what he was doing. And you knew that when he was present, he would bring all of his experience and the wide range of his contacts with him. Over the years, we in the movement have come to truly love this man for his complete dedication to Hawaiian causes, but also because of his trustworthiness. He stood for good things, always, and thus encouraged us to continue to fight for the land, for the lahui, for justice, knowing that the struggle may occupy us for an entire lifetime, as indeed it did for him. We look at this man, and we understand that he is the poster child for that struggle. And if any one of us could reach the age he reached, and look back at a similar lifetime of commitment and work, regardless of what we have achieved, it will have been a blessed life indeed. When all is said and done, my mother used to say, you answer only to God for your life. She didn't just mean that there's an audience between my soul and the Creator, although she might have had that in mind. She meant also that God represents important values and ideals that we as human beings also have to answer to. An unstinting respect for truth and integrity, a dedication of heart and soul to excellence, and a joy for God's creation, including humanity. Consider Kekuni, not just what he has done, but how he lived his life. Think of those tens of thousands of photographs of people that he has met with, talked with, and recorded. Think of what that suggests about what he really values in life. All those photographs, all those people. And then you know what truly makes a great person. In the last few years of his life, I was able from time to time to visit him at his home in Nu'uanu. And I'm very grateful to the family for allowing me and my family to come from time to time to speak with him, and mostly to sing for him, because, you know, he had a little trouble talking and expressing himself, but you could always make out one sentence that he would always ask when you got there. Pehea kalahui. How is the nation? And you better be able to answer that question when you got there. You better have something to say, because if you didn't, that meant you weren't doing anything. You weren't doing anything important. So we would talk, we would say what was going on, we would talk about our family. He would always ask about family if they weren't there. And then he would always ask for songs. And for a time we would sing together. I'm going to sing a song that he always asked for. And I dedicate this not just to Kekuni, but to Puhipau and to Leandra as well. We're really going to miss them. And yeah, I know it's this is called a celebration of life, and we celebrate the things that they did. But the bottom line is we're going to miss them, because they inspired us and they encouraged us and they were always here together with us. And so now we're without them, and we have to do this for other people. And that's just the way it goes. So, Randy Borden and I wrote this song for George Hellman and Kimo Mitchell in 1977. And it saddens me sometimes to think of how many times I've sung this song for people who have been part of this struggle. And every time I do, it's just a reminder that we are in this for our whole life. We are in this until we die, and we're never going to stop. I can recall the way your voice would fade. Older voices call.
you would have to be a beacon in the storm to guide us after Hawaiian soul. How could you leave us? You've not been lost at sea. You're only wandering Hawaiian soul. We sing your melodies and send them out to sea. You know the harmony. We will present this lei now to Auntie Nani Rogers, who is accepting these for the family of Kekuni Blasdell.